Wow, what a glorious testimony. Jesus Christ, our living hope. Without him, we really have nothing. If we didn't have Jesus that died and rose again, we wouldn't have any hope beyond this world. We wouldn't have any hope beyond the grave. We would die and we would be buried in the ground. Everybody and anybody. But because of Jesus Christ, our living hope, we have a future. We have the promise of eternal life and destiny when we have accepted Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, into our lives. We have a living hope. Yet there are still many today that live without that living hope. Not that they don't have the opportunity to have that living hope, but as Tim said, they choose not to. God has given us a choice of whether we love him and serve him or whether we stay in the world and looking at all the different things that we have in this world. We have a living hope, and I praise God for that. God, thank you. You never want to start a service without praising your name and thanking you and glorifying you, God, for who you are as Lord God Almighty, our living hope. Because of Jesus, Jesus who is the way, the truth, and the life, nobody gets to you, God, except through by accepting him into our lives, into our hearts. He can change us into new creations. We can die to the old self and be raised up into new, but only through Jesus Christ, our living hope. It's in his name I pray. Amen. Well, good morning. Thank you all for your encouragement and for your support, for your blessings, your prayers, everything that you give to Pastor Tim and myself. We appreciate you so much, and I think it's kind of ironic that we have this Pastor Appreciation Month, when really we are so grateful and so appreciative for you. If it was just Tim and I just up here and nobody was here, we'd kind of be like those clanging cymbals and those gongs, right? That there would just be nothing else going on. It takes a united body of believers in Christ that we are all sheep, although Tim and I have been called to serve in a different way, a different perspective. He and I, too, are sheep. We're also sheep because God is the chief shepherd. We are still under his guidance and his protection. This morning, I want to talk to you about investing. Last Sunday, even as I was leaving and then Monday, I kept thinking of this word investment, investment. And I thought, investment, okay, you know, and I don't ever just jump on the first thing. I always kind of take time to see what God really wants to speak to me. Is this what I'm supposed to talk about or not? And so I thought, investment, investment. And so I went to the back of my Bible, and I got to tell you, my Bible is starting to fall apart a little bit. If you go back to the back and you look in your concordance, and I'm looking up the word investment. Okay, God, what does it say about investment in the Bible? And I'm not finding anything that says specifically investment, but I thought, okay, so what's maybe another word for investment? And I thought, treasures, treasures. But when I was making up the front of the bulletin and I still went with invest, this is the picture that I found. How many of you like to play Scrabble? Any of you like to play Scrabble? Bananagrams? Oh, man, not a lot of people like to play Scrabble. All right, Cindy's on board. Cindy likes Scrabble. Jim, I've got it in my office. I've got Scrabble and Bananagrams in my office, which Bananagrams is a very fast version of Scrabble, in case you didn't know. Actually, I don't have it in my office, Jim. It's right here. Scrabble is a game that challenges your brain. And it's really good because my grandma, she lived to be 101 or 102? 102. She made it to 102. And you know, her mind was sharp as a tack when she died. She did crosswords. She played Scrabble all the time. She kept her mind fresh. She kept it going. And so the point is not in the Scrabble, but the point is more so in this bag. You see, because when you play the game of Scrabble, if you've never ever played before and this is something new for you, you reach into this bag of letters and you pull out seven letters. You get what you get. Right? Sometimes you get a good draw, sometimes you don't. So I've got an F, an L, an E, an S, and another E. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, I pulled out exactly 7. How cool is that? I got F, L, E, S, E, Q, N. See, you can look at that Q like, oh, great, I got the Q. I got the Q. But you know what? That Q is worth 10 points. That Q is worth 10 points. So the importance is, and I don't have a U to go with it, so you know I'm not going to be able to make a word for a while. But the importance is that this has a lot of points. It has a lot of value in it, but it depends on what you do with it. It depends on how you view it. Oh, I got this terrible letter, or did I get this really good letter? In life, we get what we get. God gives us these different talents, gifts, abilities. We get what we get. We can try to train ourselves to do things that we maybe don't have that specific ability. Like if I were to come over here and try to play the keyboard, it would not sound pretty at all. I could probably tink out, Mary had a little lamb, little lamb, little lamb. That's about it. I don't have that gift. Tim has that gift. You see, so it's kind of like the game of Scrabble. We get what we get. The importance is not necessarily in what we've been given, but what do we do with what we've been given? Tim has the talent of playing the keyboard and directing music and things like that. He's using his gift for God's glory. The gifts that we have, do we use them for God's glory? What is that treasure that God has given to you? Are you using it for God's glory? I was teasing the guys because Dave came in with Bill and got up on the high ladder and was cleaning out our projector, getting the dust and everything off of it so it stays running efficiently. And I was here Monday through Thursday, and they did it on Friday. I said, did you guys plan that so I wouldn't climb the ladder? Because I like to climb ladders. And the joke was that I was going to preach from it this morning, but I'm not. But, you know, I like to climb. I like to climb a lot. So if you need gutters cleaned out, call me up. I'll do it. You want me to crochet a prayer shawl? It's probably not going to look pretty. I'll try it. So we have these different gifts. We have these different talents. And we have these different abilities. And I've got this secret pile in my pocket. The diamond. The diamond. It can be anything that I want it to be. It can be anything that I want it to be in the game of Scrabble. Because we do have those different gifts, talents, and abilities. And like I said, I'm not given the gift of crocheting. I'll tell you that straight up. But I'm still going to try. I'm still going to try to do it. I'm still going to try to do my best. If I would have to play the keyboard, I would try. Do your best with what you've been given. Do your best with what you've been given. And especially use it for God's glory. The gifts that you do have, find out what those are. Find out what your gift is. I think most of us in here at our age, we should know in some type of way what our gift, our treasure is that God has given to us. to use it for His glory. And I'm thankful that Bill is up here on the bass and Don and Jeff on the guitars using their gifts for God's glory. Because you see, they were coming to church and they were sitting in their chairs, and then when Tim and them got together, isn't it such a blessing that now we have four instrumentalists up here? Praise God for that. People using their gifts for God's glory. Not just sitting around at home, not just doing it at home, but using the gifts for God's glory. That's what it's all about. All right. So, you've got what you got. So, we're going to take a look at some different treasures and the things like that that we can use. A treasure is defined as something valuable. It could be money, jewels, gold, or silver. It could be something that is very special. So, I have in my pocket some money. So, that's a piece of treasure. I have something that is very special. I have my prayer shawl, which is very, very special to me. So, it's like a treasure to me. And I have my daughter, Samantha, here with me today. And Justin, dear, don't think I'm forgetting you or Josh out there in New Mexico and Oklahoma. They can't be here. But a person who is greatly loved or valued can also be seen as a treasure. So what are those treasures that you have in your life, those things? We're going to take a look at what God's Word says about treasures, investments, and capital gains. And we're in Matthew chapter 6. Now, as we go into Matthew chapter 6, we're coming off of Jesus teaching us how to pray. He's teaching us about fasting. And then He's leading into treasures in heaven. And this is what He says: do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where the moths and the vermin destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So our first point there, anything in our lives that we hold of great value has the potential to draw us closer to God or to draw us away from God. Anything in our lives that we hold as great value has the potential to draw us closer to God or draw us away from Him. You see, because I could hold on to money, I could cling on to that treasure of the world. God could give me all these great, great riches. And it depends on what I do with it. Whether I'm clinging to it and I'm holding to it. Am I trying to make my savings account and my bank account and my stocks and my bonds and all these different things so increased that I have lots and lots of worldly wealth? But what good is that going to do me when I die? Some people work and work and work. John works with a lot of guys in his office that just work and work and work and work. Storing up money for one day they may never even be able to spend. Because you know, sometimes life is fleeting and we don't always know what tomorrow holds for us. Later on in chapter 6, it talks about that, not worrying about the things of tomorrow because we don't even know about everything that we've gotten today. We have a family member that got sick with cancer, John's mom, years ago. She had just retired. And it wasn't too long after that, within a year, I think, that she found out that she had lymphoma cancer. She went through her chemotherapy and everything, and she was healed of that. But then a couple of years later, she got leukemia. She elected to have a stem cell transplant because it would increase possibly her life for 5 more years. And so it was, do we do this or do we not do this? And I saw her, I still remember, it was on a Memorial Day weekend. We had traveled up to Illinois to go visit her. And I said, "You look so healthy, you look so good." And she was still going to have the stem cell transplant done. And she said, "I know, I feel good." She said, "But they said that if I have this transplant done, then it could possibly give me 5 more years. So she went ahead and she went through it. You know, that's a decision you have to make so much through prayer. And really seek the right answer when it comes to things like that. And so in June, she had the stem cell transplant done. They couldn't find an exact match for her. They knocked off all of the cells that they needed of her and then put these new ones into her. And she did good. She was in quarantine up there in Chicago for the first 50 days. You have to be in quarantine basically for 100 days. And she was in quarantine. She got past that 50-day mark. And they said, "If you get past that 50-day mark, you should be good to go." And she got past her 50 days and farther and farther. And then things turned. She never made it to the 100 days. You know, life is fleeting and life is short. Sometimes we work so hard to gain something in the world when we're not even promised it tomorrow. So storing up these treasures that we have in this world, anything in our lives that we hold of great value has the potential to draw us closer to God or to draw us away from Him. And as we look in the book of Philippians there in chapter 3 in verses 19 and 20, it says their destiny is destruction and their God is their stomach. Their glory is in their shame. Their mind is set on the earthly things, but our citizenship is in heaven. And we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, right? We just sang about that. The Lord Jesus, our living hope. When we have those treasures that are stored up in heaven, where the moths and the vermin, they don't destroy, we have this promise that goes beyond anything this world can give to us. I praise His name that, yes, I can sing, "Hallelujah. Praise the One who set me free. Death has lost its grip on me." That when we have our treasures stored up in heaven and we have that living hope, we don't have to worry about what tomorrow holds. Because as I was speaking to somebody on the phone this week, and she said, "I'm okay. I've got cancer and it's destroying my body. But I know that I have a hope beyond the grave." Don't you want to be able to proclaim that I have a hope beyond the grave? That whether I live or whether I die, I'm going to be okay. I'm going to be okay. So storing up those treasures, what is it that you treasure the most? Do you treasure possessions? Do you treasure money? Do you treasure your relationship with Jesus? Do you treasure your family? Do you treasure your friends? Those are the things that I treasure the most. Years ago, not a lot of years ago though, only about 4 years ago, John and I were in heavy financial debt. I had stayed at home. I was a stay-at-home mom while he worked. And to make ends meet, we used a lot of credit cards to buy our groceries, to buy our gas, to buy our food. But we were still living outside of our means. We bought a lot of stuff that we just didn't need. And so we ran up all this credit card debt, and we'd get it back down, and it'd go back up again. We refinanced our house so many times that I live in a house that we've lived in for 28 years now, and I owe just a little bit less than what I actually purchased the house for. Storing up a treasure, buying things that I didn't need, put us into huge credit card debt. And I was talking with somebody, and she said, "Christy," she said, "you are so disciplined with your exercise and with your nutrition? She's like, why can't you do that with your money? And I thought, I don't know. I've just always struggled with it. I've always struggled with the financial aspect of it. And she says, why don't you do the same as what you do with your nutrition and your exercise? Discipline yourself. She said, you don't need anything? Don't go into Kohl's. You don't need anything? Don't look at the advertisements online. She said, just start writing down everything that you spend. And so I started writing down everything that I spent. So this was in April, and I was in $10,000 of credit card debt. And I got to kind of tell you that because of the fact that, you know, you might think, oh, credit card debt, like she's like $1,000 or $2,000. No, we were $10,000. At one point in time, it was $20,000 of credit card debt. And so we were down to about $10,000, and this was April of 2018. And I was like, okay, I'm going to make it a goal to pay off that credit card by the end of the year. And I just kept praying about it. God, you have to help me with this. I've got to stay out of the stores. I have to stay offline. I need to do this. And praise God, a year later, I had $10,000 in my savings account, and my credit cards were all paid off. That's only by God's grace and by God's strength. We think that we can't do things, but if we will just be determined and focused, we can. So I have stopped storing up treasures in heaven. I know that there is something greater than the treasures that I can cling to with my hands. Point number two, talking about investments. So wherever those treasures are, so we're going into the investments. So what are you investing in? What are you investing in? Where we invest our time, energy, and money shows us the location of our heart. Because in the scripture it says that where your treasure is, there will be your heart also. So where is your treasure at? When we look at 1 John chapter 3, verse 20, it says, it says, if our hearts condemn us, we know that God is greater than our hearts, and He knows everything. When we're talking about the location of our heart, God knows what our treasure is. He knows where our focus is. He knows what we want. He knows what we desire. He knows everything about us, even the numbers of hairs on our head. So the question is, what do we invest in? As Eaton wrote, Church of God, what do we invest in? Do we invest in better looking stuff? Do we invest in upgrading things that don't need upgrading? Or do we invest in the lives of people? Yesterday, I saw us investing in the lives of people. I loved seeing all the kids come out and in their costumes. And Sister Luann, her little great-granddaughter, I guess she was, little Eleanor. Just so teeny tiny bunny, and just she'd say her name, Eleanor. Just so precious and so sweet. Those are treasures. Those are treasures. You know, it's not about the stuff that we have. It's about all of you. It's about all of you. We are God's treasure. It says there in, where is it, John? I had to pull it up for me. Exodus 19:5. That we are God's treasure. He says, now if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations, you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you are God's treasure. He loves you. My grandmother, she's 102, and I was the only one that knew what her favorite song was. Her kids and everybody else didn't know it, but I had taken the time to sit with my grandma and play Scrabble. I'm telling you, she beat me every time. She beat me every time, and I heard that Sister Ruth was a great Scrabble player, too. She probably would have beat me, too, if I would have had a chance to sit down and play Scrabble with her. She said, Christy, I want you to one day sing that song, when he cometh, to take up his jewels, all his precious jewels, his loved ones and his own, that we are the jewels in Jesus' crown. You are His treasure. So investing in our kids, investing in our community, investing in Bridgeport. I had those flyers that I needed to get over there, and I called and I said, how many flyers do I need? Will you pass these out at the school system? And they said, yeah, we can go ahead and do that, because technically, you know, it was a community outreach event. It was just located here at the church, and so it was doable. And I said, how many do I need? And she said, 775. I was like, oh, that's going to use a lot of ink and a lot of paper. But she's like, hey, just email it to me, and I'll go ahead and I'll take care of it. So praise God that we've got Bridgeport over here on our side and reaching out and partnering, right? That partnering. It's not that we just have to take hold of these treasures, but we can partner together. And down the road at hospice, that we can partner together. We don't have to do it alone. And Kenna has an opportunity for us to be able to serve at a church and making lunches and things like that a couple times a year. Partnering together for the gospel. Because all who believe in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we are those precious treasures. We are those precious jewels. It doesn't matter the denomination. It doesn't matter where you go to church. We are that treasure. What do we want to invest our time, energy, and money in? Because that shows the location of our heart. Are we investing in people, or are we investing in things? God wants us to invest in people. People. We are the treasures. And moving into point number three, those capital gains. You know, I'm not a financial wizard. I just told you I lived in debt for most of my life. Praise God, I finally am out of that. Those capital gains. I had to look up exactly what that meant, because I thought I knew what it meant, but I had to look it up. A profit that is earned on something that increases in value over a period of time. A profit earned on something that increases in value over a period of time. So the little and big things we do today make a difference in eternity. It doesn't just make a difference in eternity for each one of us. It makes a difference in eternity for those that we touch, for the kids, for the adults. You know, there's a lot of seniors that are still going around in this world that don't know Jesus. I know that because I volunteer down at hospice. People need the Lord. The gifts, the talents, the abilities, whatever that Scrabble pile is that God's given you, how are you going to use it for His glory? You can take all these piles and you can make a word out of it. You can make little words, you can make big words. You can hold on to things, you can invest them, you can let them grow. What are we going to do for eternity? How can we best serve our Savior? There is a rich ruler that came to Jesus. In the book of Matthew, chapter 19, verses 16 through 26. If you've got, I don't think I gave that one to John, so you got to open up your Bible for that one. Matthew chapter 19, verse 16 through 26. It's entitled, The Rich in the Kingdom of God. Just then a man came up to Jesus and asked, Teacher, what good thing must I do to get eternal life? Why do you ask me about what's good? Jesus replied, There's only one who is good. If you want to enter life, keep the commandments. He's like, which ones? And Jesus goes through the line of commandments and everything. He's like, well, I've done all that. All those I've kept, what do I lack? And he said, if you want to be perfect and you want to have that eternal life, sell your possessions and give them to the poor. You'll have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. The young man heard this and he went away sad because he had great wealth. You see, he thought he was doing okay by going to church and by keeping the commandments and doing all those things. But Jesus saw his heart. He saw the location of his heart, that he had all these possessions, and that's where his focus was on these possessions. He had all this stuff, and yet he was trying to go to church, and he was following the commandments, but his heart was not in the right place. He was storing up treasures on earth so much and holding so tightly that he didn't want to let go when Jesus said, go and sell everything you have to the poor, and then come and follow me. And he walks away sad because he had great wealth. We have to sometimes examine ourselves that we are blessed to be a blessing. We are blessed to be a blessing. So many times it's those who have very little that give so much. Jesus also was tempted when he went into the wilderness and he was tempted by Satan those three times. It's one of the tactics that Satan used on him. He said, look at all this. All the kingdoms of the world, I'm going to give that to you. I'm going to give that to you. And I want to look up what Jesus responded with in Matthew 4, 8 through 11. I love getting into God's Word. I'm going to have you all do a sword drill sometime. If you don't know what a sword drill is, I'll teach it to you sometime. Matthew 4, 11, finishing up, Jesus tested in the wilderness. Again, the devil took him to a high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. I'm going to give all this to you if you'll bow down and worship me. First of all, it's not Satan's, it's God's. Everything is God's. All our money, all of our possessions, our children, our grandchildren, great-grandchildren, it's all God's. Jesus said to him, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Then the devil left him, and angels came and attended him. So see, even Jesus faced temptation. The rich ruler, he struggled with what he had to let go of. In the book of Hebrews, it talks about Moses. We talked about Moses the past 2 weeks. And like I said, God kind of always ties everything in, the different pieces and the different parts. And as I was looking up treasures, I found this reference to treasures in the book of Hebrew. And when we're talking about Moses and what he did, if John, you'll pull up that scripture in Hebrews, this will be our last scripture for today. By faith, Moses' parents, remember, they hid him for 3 months after he was born because they saw he was no ordinary child because they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he grew up, he refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt, because he was looking ahead to his reward. By faith he left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He persevered because he saw who? He saw him who is invisible. God. God. Even Moses gave up the treasures of this earth so that he could know God in a more intimate way. Tim, if you want to come on up. So where is your treasure today? I'm not just talking about money, because we all have different types of treasures. Like I said, treasures can be money, or treasures can be something special that we cling to, hold on to. Jenny loves when I wear my prayer shawl. So I'm going to put on my prayer shawl. The things that we hold on to, or the people in our lives. I've learned time and time again, almost every day really, that I need to have open hands, that what God gives to me is not mine to keep. He gives it. He blesses us so that we can be a blessing. So as he blesses me, I can bless others. Whether that's with my finances, whether that's with my time. I find that now more and more my time is getting shorter just because I want to try to take care of all of you. I want to try to give each one of you the special moments, the special times, text or email or a phone call or a visit. Time is short for me. You know, sometimes I wonder, too, how short is my time on earth? I've had cancer before. Will I have cancer again? We don't know what tomorrow holds. The treasures that we cling to, can we not be like the rich young ruler? Can we hold those things with open hands and what God gives to us that we can release it? Release it to Him, bless others. God has a plan. He always, always has a plan. Search your heart today. Ask Him. Search your heart today. Is there anything that you're clinging to? God, I pray for us. Pray for us. Not just for me, God. Not just for the congregation. God, for us. We are a family. We take care of one another. When one has a heartache, we all feel that pain. When another one rejoices, God, we rejoice with them. Help us, Lord, as the believers back in Acts, they shared everything, their heartaches, their pains, their possessions, their finances. God, help us to not cling to the things of this world. Help us to remember that you're our living hope and we have a future hope with you when we surrender everything to you. Everything. Praise you and lift you up, Jesus. For it's in your name I pray. Amen.
What He's done for me. Would you please stand?